Awesome to be here. So a few disclosures. Number one, no financial advice is being given out here. And number two, I hold Civic. And so with that, what is Civic and why should everyone buy it?
Hey, Michael. You know I can't answer that question.
But let's start with the first part of that. What is Civic?
Civic is essentially a network model. We've taken the notion that identity is stored in centralized databases, you know, with, for example, the credit providers, and that information is charged on an access fee basis to third parties. You know. So when you open up a bank account, the bank contacts the credit bureaus. They give your information to the bank to verify it. They may ask you some questions to try and verify that you are who you say you are. But in the end, like, these databases are getting hacked all day long. And last year, we saw a big hack, 150 million mm-hmm. Records. Records of people were hacked. And you know, I think the model we've been building for the past 2.5 years is to decentralize that information. It's your personal information. You should keep it on your devices, and you should share it with whoever you want to share it with. If you want to open up a bank account, get a book from the library, even it shouldn't matter. This is your ID information. And so, if you do it this way, there's no way that a hack can affect the entire network. It's all stored on the device. So your Civic doesn't store your information. We just provide the rails that makes this all possible.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, the crypto market generally has a lot of really great energy, enthusiasm, some people will say hype. But in your case, there's actually a product. And I'm going to zoom on that a little bit. Where can people actually, you know, reach out and touch Civic in the real world? Where is Civic being used? How does it actually look in real life?
Yeah, we have a number of partners right now that are using Civic. WikiHow.com is the biggest. They've got 150 million plus monthly active users. Shapeshift's Prism.exchange as well, if you use Shapeshift. And we have more partners rolling out every month and every week right now. The KYC product is being rolled out. We have a few people using it now for ICOs. So that essentially means when you participate in ICO, instead of emailing, you know, back and forth, and insecurely, obviously, your passport, your driver's license, your utility bills, you scan it with your phone, you verify the information through Civic, and we help you transmit it from your device securely to the third party where they can validate that information and open up an account for you. So that's going to, and then once you've done it once on your phone, you don't have to do it again. You don't have to keep scanning your information or trying to re-email it through. Email is a very insecure way to transmit your personal information.
And I remember that, you know, the KYC model especially is really interesting for sort of current ICOs and token sales. Really sort of a great way to validate accredited investors, what have you, remain compliant. And I remember in your own ICO, part of the way to buy in, I didn't get in early enough, was setting up my own Civic account and going through sort of the accreditation process and verification process using your own platform. It's a really cool way to do that. Now, you know, you've done an ICO, and, you know, this industry is so fresh that you are still considered one of the sort of older companies. You've been around a while, right? A few years now, imagine that. But how is the sort of token sale slash ICO slash whatever is the most compliant way to call this thing now? How has that changed since you guys have run your token offering?
Yeah, I think what's really changed is the SEC was obviously, giving some feedback last week around what are ICOs, what are token sales, and I think there's a strong view that a large portion, I'd say close to most ICOs today, are securities. They're deemed to be securities, so obviously security laws start jumping into the picture. Like before, a year ago, you could have an ICO, you could take tokens from anywhere in the world, have a smart contract running, etc. And that's just totally moving towards you having to verify and validate that if you are accepting American investors or people buying tokens, that there's an accreditation check that gets done. There's KYC that gets done, which is know your customer, ID verification. And if you're not accepting US persons, then you have to prove that as well. So regulators are getting in worldwide on this and saying, look, you can't have this just run away wildfire. What are the guardrails that need to come in place? Because their concerns, obviously, there's lots of scams out there, there's money laundering happening, etc. And they're trying to make sure that there is some... I don't think they're trying to destroy the sector. I think everyone's pretty optimistic about what it can produce, but there are some bad spots where people are losing money by putting money to illegitimate companies, organizations. And I think when people lose money, that's when regulators get involved. And when the market was just going up and up, they were kind of standing on the sidelines. But now that the market's kind of tanked a bit the past month, now they're sort of stepping up.
Mm-hmm. And so in your opinion, then, is regulation a good thing or a bad thing? And how much of it?
So I think you know, left in the hands of regulators alone, I think it's a bad thing.
Mm-hmm.
I think if industry and regulators work together to try and find what's the happy medium, what's the happy norm here, I think that's probably a more balanced outcome. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's reasonable to expect that regulators are not going to get involved.
And if you were going to be writing the laws yourself, any ideas of what kinds of things you want to put into effect first?
You know, it's a very difficult question because I think it applies differently to each company and what part of the world you're in, mm-hmm. what access to resources. But you know, if it was based in Silicon Valley, there's probably better history of startups and how startups are built out, et cetera, out here. But then you've got the other half of it saying, well, this is crypto, it's different. Mm-hmm. The reality is if you're raising money and you're using it to build products and technologies and whatnot, and it's not really crypto, it's more... you know, you're using the token to raise capital. Mm-hmm, it's a security.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And so it differs from country to country, I think.
So let's zoom in on that a little bit. You called it a security. Are you generally resigned to believe that tokens are securities? So could they be utility? Could they be something else entirely?
No. I think there's actually there's a spectrum of use cases for tokens, right? Mm-hmm. So you do have monetary bases like Bitcoin, Monero, Zcash, Bitcoin Cash, Litecoin. These are large monetary bases that people are using as decentralized currencies. You've got utility tokens like Ethereum, mm-hmm. For example, and Civic, where there's actually a use case for the tokens. And then you've got securities. Now, security is actually quite easy because securities on the blockchain is basically a security that could happen offline, but instead of it being not tradable, et cetera, now it's in a tokenized form. So for example, you can go and take debt from a bank and owe the bank $1 million, or you can go take debt from a whole bunch of people and give them all a token and allow them to redeem that debt or trade it with each other at some value. It's the same thing. It functions as debt.
Mm-hmm. And something that seems to kind of be the case is, you've gone through multiple internet life cycles. There was sort of incubating, click to customers, kind of old school SEO marketing. Then you've got Yola and Gift, kind of like the Web 2.0, sort of great exit with Google Ventures. And now we're kind of entering this kind of 3.0 phase of the internet. It's a lot of the same stuff. A bank will lend you money, but now maybe you're tokenizing that debt asset. So I wonder, kind of zooming out a little bit, what are the qualities of Internet 3.0 as you guys are sort of building it?
I think every phase is different, but there are some learnings that are consistent. Well, what I found with each phase of what I've been doing in my career as an entrepreneur is that it's always about the people and the people you work with. And so the expectations of the market can be out of whack. So like we have today, we have too many people buying tokens in companies that actually have very long sales cycles for what they're building. Mm-hmm. And people don't appreciate how much work's going to go into some of these companies that are raising doing these token sales and raising this money are building enterprise solutions that will take 2 to 3 years to get into production in a bank, in a financial institution, mm-hmm. et cetera. And so the people you work with and the people you invest in are what's consistent throughout mm-hmm. all the things I've done in my career. It's like I always want to back people who understand how to get products to market sooner rather than later. Yeah. Because what happens with these long sales cycles is you run out of money. Now, I think this is the scary part about the token economy is with all these great ideas that are out there, what happens when a company who's issued tokens and maybe retained a percentage of the tokens runs out of money? No one's really mm-hmm. dealt with that. There's been a couple of edge cases. But what happens when they run out of money? Can they do I've actually had someone say, we'll do another ICO. It's like, how do you do another ICO? Yeah. You've committed to those people who bought in the first one that this is the fixed number of tokens you're issuing. You can't just do another one. Now, obviously, if you've got some tokens in reserve, you can sell them, but that's a bad signal if it's not well thought through and planned and whatnot. So as a investor in companies, I invest in people, and I look for good people who understand that we don't have all the answers. We don't know how this is going to shape up over the next 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 years. But if you invest in the right people, on average, you should do better than just buying tokens based upon white papers.
Mm-hmm. And on that note, you're an investor with Multicoin Capital, with Newton Partners. Both have their own sort of distinct nuances. But what kinds of companies are you looking for? What's the general thesis there besides the people, maybe?
So, okay, Newtown Partners, I co-founded about 3 years ago, 4 years ago. We're focusing on token economy design Multicoin Capital. I joined as a general partner recently, and that's more of a hedge fund that invests in the crypto economy businesses. Those two are two different beasts. Newtown Partners are working with early stage companies that one of the things with token with just putting out a token is if you want to issue a security, fine, say look, we're going to go raise $30 million years 30 million tokens $1 a piece and sell to the market and register it as a security and just accept that it's a security and like a share it could trade on a marketplace. Or you could say, well, is there a way of us building a utility token into our model? Is there something that we could use these tokens for that makes it not a security? And so that's a very difficult process. And when I say difficult, it's easy to just raise the money, but then what happens is that people don't understand how these tokens trade in the aftermarket, and they go through, you know, pump and dump groups, which just pump the price up and sell them, and it's like penny stocks on the stock market. So versus tokens that have real utility that people can that companies need it. So if you go and build out ecosystems for your products and services, and the people within the ecosystem needs it. Like for example, with Ether, you need Ethereum to be in the ecosystem. There's actually utility within Ether for gas, etc. So I think it's about focusing on understanding what when you're doing a token sale, etc. What you want to do with it.
And this is something we were talking about backstage. You know, when you're doing an ICO, again, fairly easy to raise money. Building hype isn't so hard as much. But really, figuring out what to do once you've raised the money is the hard part. And whether it's raising more money because you've run out, or it's building the economy, or figuring out a governance model, like, what are some of the sophisticated things that you've had to think about now that Civic has been around for a little while?
Well, I mean, for us, it's more about just getting to the point where the product is. The basic product's live right now, but how do we get to the next major milestone, which is Q3, where we have our marketplace coming up? The marketplace is where you would basically be able to reuse credentials from your existing bank at opening account with another bank or with a retailer, and they would need to accept it. So for us, it's more about milestones. We have a roadmap. We've published at civic.com/marketplace. And it kind of shows you where we're going with the company. So we've planned, we've hired up to about 35 people as a company right now. We're keeping it small, very nimble startup in a sense. But we do have a roadmap that helps us get our product to the point where there's real utility for the tokens to be used in the economy.
Yeah, and you've done a lot of the heavy lifting on Civic, you know, in the early days, figuring out that economy. You know, there's probably some aspiring crypto founders here, even some folks maybe going in through their ICO or aspiring to. And I wonder, you know, how should they think about building their economic model? What's that process like?
Yeah, it's one of constant learning and evolution. I don't think it's something where you should go in with the understanding that the start of this industry right now, we are in early days. I mean, this is the first. Look, Bitcoin's been around for, 9 years now? It's still pretty early in terms of the technology. In terms of it going to the semi-mainstream, this audience, you guys in front of us, Silicon Valley, the tech community in the world, it's in the first 2 years. What we know today about token economies is a fraction of what we'll know in 3 to 4 years' time. So what we need to do is go forward with the notion that we don't know everything. This is the trajectory. It's going to be a very, very steep learning curve. And maybe in 3 to 4 years' time, we'll know half or 60% of what a mature industry will be. But because we're so early on, you need to not paint yourself in a corner. So start off by taking baby steps and saying, well, what's the long-term goal of whatever you're building? It's to have a vibrant economy. How do we make sure that we can ensure that? How do we ensure that it functions with all parties, whatever their needs are, who are the stakeholders? And just be considerate and deliberate about your intentions. That dives into governance models for companies as well.
And how does one design then a governance model to support that?
So one of the problems that I'm seeing right now is in the market, there's a big disconnect between venture-backed startups and token companies. And obviously in the middle, you've got different types of variations where you have companies that don't have VCs on board raising a ton of money. We are venture-backed. So now I'm not sure people have thought through the conflicts of interest here. When you have shareholders who have given you capital as a company, they want returns as a shareholder, as shareholders in the company. When you have token holders who have bought tokens, they want the token price to go up presumably, or they want to be able to use the tokens or whatever the reason they bought the tokens, it's separate from the shareholders. So these two different classes of stakeholders that you've got. Mm-hmm. And so what do you do when you have sold a big dream about what you're going to do with the tokens and you go build this whole token infrastructure company that you've put out there? And what do you do when you have deals that come to the table that are in conflict? So for example, you're building your grand vision, and someone comes in, a partner comes in and says, oh, we'll pay you $1 million to do a custom configuration of your technology for us. Now, as a shield of the company, you're like, well, that sounds great. $1 million in extra income this year. dividends should be great. Mm-hmm. But the token holders, what do they get out of that? If you're taking two or three of your best developers off whatever they're building right now for token holders to go work on this other project so that your shareholders get a benefit, do you see how the conflict of interest comes in? And so this is the problem. I think it's a big problem because you basically have two masters. You're trying to make sure that the token holders and your shareholders get benefit out of the actions of the company.
Mm-hmm. When you're structuring the deal on the venture side, I guess you're probably doing these simultaneously with a private sale. What are you offering the investors there, assuming that you're not going to sell a post-ICO company, so they're not going to get necessarily a liquidity event? What kind of things do you do to sweeten the deal for them?
Well, this is, this is the problem. Are the interests aligned? Right. I think it's very difficult with existing shareholders, and if you're a new company, you're just doing a SAFT or whatever, it's probably a bit easier because you're trying to align everyone with the interest of having the tokens. Mm-hmm. But I think it's more of a challenge than people realize. And it's okay now because we're in a bit of a honeymoon phase. There's lots of money floating around and everyone's raising capital is easy. If we're going to a bit of a dip where that's not the case and companies start running out of money and then you go to your shareholders and say, well, we need more money, then they start asking the questions like, well, why are you busy working on this token thing? The money's gone. We're putting new money in. Kill the token economy, go and sell this product to enterprise, and I guarantee that's going to happen at some point. At some point, some company has to go raise private capital because they can't get capital in the crypto markets, and crypto holders are going to be left being bag holders.
Mm-hmm. And so from the investor side, how should the investors be approaching deals with companies that maybe they're accepting venture, maybe they're accepting a venture a sort of equity to coin convertible, or maybe they're accepting only token, but how should venture capital companies look at companies going through an ICO in terms of backing?
So that's another good question. I don't know the answer to that one. I think it's with existing investors. I can give you the view that I've given my shareholders. We as Civic Inc. are the largest token holder in the CVC, the Civic Token Economy. So all our efforts as a company is focused on building that economy. So all our development, all our design, everything focused on how do we make and create value for Civic token holders, of which we're one of them, by building this infrastructure out. There's no short-term interest in doing a deal to go get $1 million of the revenue in on the side. That's just not how we're playing this. And so I've been public about this before, that we eventually will probably become a non-profit vehicle or some sort of a foundation. And we have a way of doing that, but the reason we would do that is because we would align all the interests of token holders and shareholders under one sort of aligned, unified vision. And that could be years from now. But I think it's largely up to the management team to make sure that there's not this divergence of interests between different stakeholders.
Mm-hmm. Cool. And with that, we've got an excellent Q&A coming up with Vinny in Theater 20. But the last question will be, what would help Civic right now?
Right now, I think obviously if you're if you're doing an ICO and you need to do KYC, contact us. You can email mike@civic.com, mike@civic.com, and get set up to use our technology. But just feedback's always good, so give us feedback. I'm always on Twitter, and just use the product. And thank you.
Sweet, thanks a lot. Let's give Vinny a hand. Good stuff.